This is shuttle launch control at T-minus 3 hours and holding. See the astronauts at the breakfast table for this morning's launch attempt. There's mission specialist Jan Davis and her husband, payload commander Mark Lee. Here is shuttle pilot Kurt Brown. And this morning's STS-47 commander, Hoot Gibson. There's a mission specialist and flight engineer, Jay Apt. Mission specialist, Mae Jamison. And the payload specialist, Dr. Mamoru Mori of Japan. Half of the crew were awakened at about 4:58 this morning, and the other three were awakened at 5:28 in preparation for this morning's launch attempt. Sitting in the middle of the table is a traditional cake made for every launch team, and it has the emblem STS-47 crew patch. This is the STS-47 crew patch, which was designed by the astronauts. You can see the oval-shaped logo is surrounded by the names of the seven astronauts. SLJ on the left side stands for Space Lab Japan, with the Japanese letters on the right meaning Fuwato, or weightlessness in Japanese. The shuttle orbiter is flanked by the flags of the United States on its starboard side and the flag of Japan on the port side. And you can see that the orbiter is flying over the United States state of Alaska and the country of Japan. And this is indicative of the 57 degree or high inclination orbit that we'll be having over the 7-day flight. We're currently standing by to receive some video of the astronauts, the STS-47 crew, as they're donning their flight pressure suits in preparation for today's launch. Here's Commander Hoot Gibson. Gibson is going to be making his fourth trip in space today. A veteran of three previous flights, most recently the launch of Atlantis on STS-27 back in November of 1988. Here's mission specialist and payload commander Mark Lee. Lee will be making his second trip in space today. He flew previously on STS-34. Here you see pilot Kurt Brown being assisted with the donning of his gloves. Brown will be making his first trip in space today. These orange day-glow outfits are essentially pressure suits that the astronauts wear during entry into Earth orbit and re-entry back here upon landing. Here's Japanese payload specialist Dr. Mamoru Mori. Dr. Mori will become the first professional Japanese astronaut to fly in space today, and he's very pleased to be going and gives us a thumbs up. Mori has been training to fly on the SLJ mission for about 7 years. He's a mission specialist and STS-47 flight engineer Jay Apt. Apt is checking out his communications on his helmet, and he'll be making his second trip in space, having flown previously on STS-37 when the Compton Gamma Ray Observatory was deployed. Footage inside the operation and checkout building crew quarters is provided by technicians with the Lockheed Space Operations Company and with photographers and a film cameraman from the Bionetics Corporation. Here you see Mae Jamison. Mae Jamison will be making her first trip in space today, and she's also very enthusiastic and ready to fly. Jamison is a medical doctor from Chicago. Here you see mission specialist Jan Davis. Davis will be making her first trip in space today. This is shuttle launch control at T-minus 2 hours 55 minutes, and the STS-47 astronauts have just emerged from their suit-up room in the astronaut quarters. Commander Hood Gibson and pilot Kurt Brown leading the way, and Japanese payload specialist Mamoru Mori and mission specialist Mae Jamison picking up the rear. Here they come from the operation and checkout building. Commander Hoot Gibson leading the way, followed by Kurt Brown, Jay App, Mars Lee and his wife Jan Davis, Mae Jamison, and Mamoru Mori. They've trained a long time for this mission, 7 years for Dr. Mori, two or more years for the rest of the crew, and they're ready to fly today. A lot of press interest in this mission. We have more than 100 members of the Japanese media who've come out to see their payload specialist, Dr. Mori, off, and everybody's pretty excited. A lot of flashes going off there, and a lot of applause. The crew will journey to the launch pad in this specially outfitted recreational vehicle, which is called the Astrovan. And it's about a 10-mile trip out to pad 39B. The crew should be out there in about 20 minutes. Out of the pad, the shuttle Endeavour and members of the closeout crew await their arrival. Once at the foot of the pad, the astronauts will take the elevator to the 195-foot level of the fixed service structure, where they'll begin entry into Endeavour. T-minus 17 seconds. We're coming up on a go for main engine start.
10. CLS is go for main engine start.
We have main engine start. 2, 1. Solid rocket ignition and liftoff. Liftoff of Endeavour on America's 50th space shuttle flight.
Houston now controlling.
Houston, Endeavour is with you in the hole.
Roger, roll Endeavour.
Maneuvers complete aboard Endeavour. Orbiter is now in a heads-down position on course for a 57-degree, 160 nautical mile orbit. Throttling down now at 67% as Endeavour prepares to pass through the area of maximum dynamic pressure.
Endeavour Houston, go with throttle up.
Roger, go with throttle up.
1 minute, 20 seconds into the flight. Endeavour is now 7 miles from the launch site, altitude 11 nautical miles. Now traveling 2,400 feet per second, or about 1,700 miles per hour. The next event is a burnout of the solid rocket boosters. That occurs at about 2 minutes.
Endeavour Houston, UHF comm check. How do you read?
UHF. 2 minutes into the flight now, Endeavour is 21 miles away from the Kennedy Space Center. Solid rocket booster separation confirmed. Standing by for the first stage performance call.
Endeavour Houston, performance nominal.
Roger, copy, nominal performance.
This is Mission Control. These are our live views of the crew starting to come into the Space Lab module.
And Endeavour Houston, we're with you now in Space Lab J.
Yeah, it's finally, it's great to get back in here after training at this for a long time. We got Mamoru probably blinding you a little bit with the camera, but taking a few pictures with the 16 millimeter.
Yeah, you know, the crew of STS-48 would just you know, like to thank you. That was quite a show you put on for our one-year anniversary today.
Downlink video from the Space Lab module with mission specialists May Jemison and Jan Davis performing two experiments at this time. Jan Davis is working with the continuous heating furnace and working on the aluminum composite experiment. She's involved in the first sample installation of this experiment. May Jemison works with the gas bulb experiment, the activation and preparation.
And Space Lab Huntsville, we're getting a great view of you two. We noticed that Jan's headband is a little bit loose, her AFTE headband. But this is a great view, and you guys are really looking good.
Okay, we got good picture now, Mark. Oh, yeah, we see everything really well. Can you determine a source for the leak, Mark? Does it look like it's coming around fittings or a cracked pipe or something?
No, I don't see anything. It just bubbles up around the valve. In rack 8, there's no leakage at all. And there's also now a little bit over by the other valve also.
Looking at the gas evaporation facility, we can see the filament inside the bulb. Looking through a TV camera attached to the facility.
And Space Lab Huntsville, we've got live video in the module, and we see May down working on GEF, looking great.
Go on my mark, 3, 2, 1, mark.
Copy.
Space Lab operations in Huntsville, getting an excellent view and downlink video of the gas bulb with the filament inside the bulb. These are oriental hornets. They have a unique ability to build combs, and those combs are oriented in the direction of gravity. So the objective here is to determine what effect the absence of gravity as a reference point will have on their activities in building combs or
sunshine here in Munich. I'm enjoying and doing a lot of work, so that I'm very busy. So I hope you are doing quite well, all of you.
Following the removal of the insulation, Mission Specialist Mark Lee will conduct an inspection of the valves and the fittings and the lines and observe for any leakage that may have occurred.
Yeah, may I copy that? This last frog has several abnormal-looking eggs. We don't like this last one much at all.
Receiving downlink TV from the aft flight deck at mission lapse time of 8 hours 16 minutes on the second day of flight. This is Mission Control Houston. Downlink television from the payload bay of Endeavour, now showing sun glint on Vancouver in British Columbia.
Okay, this is number 23, also in great shape.
the science team here in Huntsville watching the swimming behavior of the tadpoles in the two-part flask.
This downlink television from Endeavour is of the Oregon coast and the Willamette Valley. Right now we can see the cities of Eugene and Salem, and just out of sight on the right of the picture is Portland.
Endeavour Houston, looking good on final. You're still go for the drag chute DTO. Surface winds are calm.
Okay, copy.
Endeavour's wings leveling. Altitude 9,000 feet, 6 miles to touchdown. Speed 297 knots, 6,000 feet. Landing gear down and locked. Main gear touchdown. Drag chute deploy. Nose gear touchdown.
Roger, wheels stop. Endeavour, congratulations on a highly successful and historic mission. Stand by for post-landing deltas.
Thanks, Kenny.
Seven astronauts taking a few moments here to pose for some photos in front of Endeavour. Japanese payload specialist Mamoru Mori, Mae Jamison, mission specialist, along with Jan Davis, mission specialist, and Jay Apt, Mark Lee, who was payload commander of the flight, Kurt Brown, and the commander of the mission was Robert Hoot Gibson. The astronauts are now preparing to board the Astrovan. It's a specially outfitted recreation vehicle that the astronauts travel back and forth to the pad in, and which they'll be heading back to their astronaut crew quarters.